The 1980s was a maze of musical sounds and images. Post-punk, glam rock, and new romantics all competed for the listener's ear. But there was a single figure which personifies both the look and the sound that was quintessentially 80s. His name? Boy George. Lead singer for the multi-platinum selling pop group Culture Club. In an age of copycat stars and manufactured success stories, Boy George is a rarity in the world of pop music, an androgynous, outspoken star who is entirely his own creation. Along with Culture Club, he sold over 45 million records, toured the world, and became one of the most photographed celebrities on the planet. So how did this international pop icon end up picking up garbage on the streets of New York?
Nothing to lose.
Leads you to where you are today.
I believe in storytelling.
I decided to make you a star.
I'm still trying to figure that out. I never felt quite well.
In October 2005, Boy George called the New York police to report a break-in in his apartment. When the police arrived, they discovered no signs of a disturbance, but what they did discover was 13 small packets of cocaine lying next to his computer, and charged him with suspected possession. George was found guilty. His punishment? To clean the streets of New York.
How can you go from being someone that is so against drugs to being so reckless with your own life?
It did break my heart watching it. I respect other people's choices, and no matter how hurtful it is, you just have to stand back and watch sometimes.
I don't believe that anybody who uses drugs to excess is happy.
George Allen O'Dowd, better known as Boy George, was born on June 14, 1961, and raised in this end-of-terrace house in Eltham, a working-class area of South London.
It was a noisy, boisterous, confrontational household, very working class. They lived on a housing estate in South London. His mother was born in Dublin, very Irish, came over as a barmaid, was a housewife. Father was a builder, self-employed builder. He was violent towards his wife. He punched her when she was pregnant with George in the stomach. On the wall, they had a picture of the Pope and Muhammad Ali. So that kind of gives you an indication of the two sort of passions, if you like. And all the kids would just bish, bash, bosh all the time, and he learned how to defend himself. And that was probably before he had an awareness that he was gay. He was just a child who was different.
As a teenager, George began calling attention to himself by emulating the look of popular glam rockers like David Bowie and T-Rex's Mark Bolan.
As a kid, he would hang outside Bowie's house in Beckenham, South East London. He would hang out outside radio stations seeking autographs. So the world of glamour that was out there, something he always wanted to be part of.
At the dawn of the 80s, when punk was like virtually left a ruin on the streets of the King's Road, places that had popularized this idea of the look of music, as well as the sound of that fashion, there was a determined new feeling to actually embrace fashion. What this new generation wanted to do was just simply to dress up and become one giant chocolate box with a huge satin ribbon on top. They had this idea they wanted to embrace themselves as stars, and in doing so, this new romantic movement was born. And Boy George was a kid of that generation.
By 1976, when he was 17, George had surrounded himself with a group of friends who looked as outrageous as he did.
This was the beginnings of the scene that was to kick off the 80s, if you like. And in that environment, it was only going to be natural that Boy George, this face, this made-up face, that neither was a girl nor a boy, was going to be a perfect icon for a generation who were going to experiment with their sexuality at the age of 14 and decide they could be both. They could walk both sides of the fence.
My first recollections of ever seeing or meeting Boy George was when I was going up the underground station up at Piccadilly, and I heard this, look at her in a new bondage suit. So I looked behind and sort of thought, oh, these look quite interesting people. It was about 6 months later that I started up my first club, which was named after David Bowie. It was at a place called Billy's, and the night was called Heroes.
Heroes was the first new romantic nightclub, and Steve employed George as a cloakroom attendant.
I really did take sympathy on George, and it wasn't that I was belittling him, as he says, by putting him in a cloakroom. I thought the money that he took, made from taking coats, would be a nice little earner for him.
As a cloakroom attendant, he wasn't the most reliable of people, and you might find that certain valuables were missing when you got your handbag back.
I had to give them a sack because he was actually picking people's pockets, and money was going from people's handbags and stuff like that. I mean, he holds his hands up to it, you know.
After being fired from Heroes, George continued to party in London's underground club scene. In 1980, he managed to attract the attention of star maker Malcolm McLaren, who had previously managed punk innovators, the Sex Pistols. McLaren's latest creation was a group called Bow Wow Wow, whose lead singer was 14-year-old Annabella Lewin.
During the composite and makeup of the group Bow Wow Wow, I thought, why can't you just throw in another singer into the mix? Of course, I never cared much for the politics of groups and always concerned about protecting themselves and worrying about who they are. I never bothered. I was quite tyrannical, I suppose, and all I thought was, yeah, throw this kid into the mix. Kick Annabella off stage and have George sing a song or two. George was open arms, ready to rock, as they say.
And rock he did. Taking to the stage like a seasoned veteran, George was at home, center stage, with all eyes looking at him. At just 19 years old, Boy George had made it, or so he thought. It was 1980. Music impresario, fashion guru, and Sex Pistols manager Malcolm McLaren decided his new band, Bow Wow Wow, fronted by Annabella Lewin, needed a second singer. This was Boy George's big break. But things started to go downhill the moment he walked onto the stage.
I never realized how fans can be so partisan, you know. Where's Annabella? How come she's been pushed off the stage? Who's this bloody bloke? You know, and it was, I was kind of thinking how reactionary these kids are. I didn't understand it. And then, of course, the complaints came from the backstage. The boys playing the guitar, the drums, the bass, all terrified. They were going to be buggered. The band members disganged up and decided George has got to go.
George was fired from Bow Wow Wow after only two performances.
George knew that he, I think, missed his niche with Bow Wow Wow and was determined that, you know, he was going to get a band together.
Through his association with Malcolm McLaren, however, George met bass player Mikey Craig.
Mikey spotted George at a nightclub and approached him, asked him if he'd like to be in a band. And George definitely had made up his mind at that point that he wanted to be a performer. He'd seen John Moss, I think, in the street and quite fancied him. He was looking around for a guitarist, and someone had heard about Roy, and Roy came in, and then they all teamed up, decided to meet and try and form a group together. I think the first name was Sex Gang Children, and they kind of realized it was probably a bit too alternative, and they were interested in being successful.
There was no way those backroom musicians that were going to support him were going to turn against him, And the way to do that was to make certain at least one was gay, and that was the drummer. And so the drummer was to become his boyfriend. And the other two better pay lip service. And they did.
Because they came from this very visual club crowd, they were designed to kill. And this whole idea of the inclusiveness was one that made Culture Club, and what a brilliant name, an immediately successful concept. You had so many different types of people represented within this quartet. You had white and black, Christian and Jew, straight and gay, and you even had a kind of dreadlock element. It was a group for everybody.
By the end of 1981, when George was 20, Culture Club had secured time to record a demo.
The very first time I met George actually was in the recording studio of the first day of the first recording session for Culture Club. The vocal that you hear on Do You Really Want to Hurt Me is George's one complete take, and the entire backing track was done in one take without any edits on it at all.
When I first time I heard it on the radio in my bedroom in London at the time, I thought, phew, that's going to be a monster. Do you really want to hurt me?
Do you really want to make me cry? Culture Club managed to secure a spot on Britain's premier music show, Top of the Pops. Over the following week, the British press splashed George on its front covers, speculating over the sexuality and appearance of this androgynous creature. Britain had discovered its newest, most outrageous pop star. And within a week, Do You Really Want to Hurt Me leapt from number 38 in the charts to number 3.
From that appearance, suddenly, they were literally an overnight sensation.
Do You Really Want to Hurt Me eventually reached number 1 in over a dozen countries, launching the career of one of the most successful pop groups of the 1980s.
Listen, if you're doing your makeup on your face for the whole day, every day, for 3 years prior to you singing Do You Really Want to Hurt Me, I mean, you're going to make that a hit no matter what. I mean, you've been planning it for years.
I do believe the Culture Club were the first British group since the Beatles to have 3 American top 10 singles from their debut album. Do You Really Want to Hurt Me? Time, Clock of the Heart, and I'll Tumble For You, which oddly enough was not released as a single in Britain. But was so popular in America that I even saw Billy Joel at the Royal Albert Hall just break into it spontaneously.
What the public didn't realize, however, is that most of Culture Club's hits were about George's relationship with drummer John Moss.
It was John Moss who was so crucial. John, the drummer, and for the time of their great fame, their lover, his lover.
The line, "Do you really want to hurt me? Do you want to make me cry?" was about him and John, and their relationship was tempestuous right from the start. Do you really want to
hurt me? The hits kept coming, and legions of fans took George to their hearts, snapping up Culture Club albums by the millions.
I think the reason people fell in love with certain songs, because we all have dramas in our life. We all have somebody who we feel hurt us, and you know, and that's why I think the combination of this really beautiful voice combined with the lyrics is, I think, what touches, but I guess we'd have to ask the fans, you know.
To many people who heard Do You Really Want to Hurt Me, it was assumed that there would be a string of reggae-influenced hits. But the next record, Time, Clock of the Heart, was utterly different. But no one could ever have been prepared for the kind of bubblegum of Karma Chameleon.
It was their biggest worldwide hit. Went to number 1 in America, sold over 1 million singles there. And it was huge worldwide. Certainly made their fortunes. And as George said, none of the other band complained when they got their royalty checks.
the essence of the song, just like the chameleon. Chameleon's constantly changing its colour, and I believe that's to do with mood changes, mood swings, and that thing of, you know, Karma Chameleon constantly changing.
Between their first hit in 1982 and 1986, Culture Club racked up 7 consecutive top 10 hits in the UK and 6 in the US. And with fame came even more publicity.
George was a natural for television because he was visually so interesting and he was quick-witted.
The media ran riot with him. Unlike with the Sex Pistols, where they only ran riot on the basis they must be destroyed now, a giant hole must be dug and they must disappear from all humankind, this detritus, you know. On the other hand, with Boy George, no, he must be invited into every house where mother can make him a cup of tea and feed him a cucumber sandwich and ask him, how long does it take, George? Can I call you George? How long does it take to do your makeup?
If you recall, he was asked about his sex life, and he said, I'd rather have a cup of tea. And he gave good value. And when they won the Best New Artist of the Grammy Awards, he said, thank you, America. You know a good drag queen when you see one.
At the height of his fame, George was immortalized in wax. And he was even asked to appear on an episode of The A-Team. He reveled in the attention, but would his overexposed image kill his first love, Culture Club? Throughout the mid-1980s, Boy George's band Culture Club was one of the hottest pop acts in the world. But while their talent was undeniable, the band's fame rested nearly as much on George's androgynous look and the wild speculation on his sexual orientation as it did on the band's music. Although Culture Club kept churning out the hits, George's increasing fame resulted in clashing egos within the group. This was made worse by George's turbulent relationship with drummer John Moss, making it almost impossible for the band to work together.
They kind of thought they were great without realizing they actually had to work at it. Those early days of inspiration were a bit too easy. The songs came too easily. And they never realized that if they didn't work at it, they weren't going to produce good material. And in the end, the material was just too weak. They threw it together within a matter of days. And album songs, and they just, the hits weren't there.
By the time we started recording the sessions for the third album, the cracks had already started to appear. His time was being limited so dramatically by both the record company and the demands of journalists and television interviewers. He was feeding their demands for interview, but of course wasn't being able to spend that time in the recording studio to make the record. So I think that album suffered from lack of attention. There are one or two songs on that album that I was only left with guide vocals, and I had to make up a finished vocal performance from not a completed vocal because there just wasn't the time.
And as the hits dried up, so they turned on each other, and there wasn't enough of a foundation for them to hold together as friends, or in George and John's case, as a relationship. And they went their separate ways.
In February 1985, the band took a hiatus. Mikey Craig and Roy Hay pursued outside projects, as did John Moss, who had now permanently split with Boy George.
So Culture Club really was John Moss and Boy George in the sense that that was the driving force for the creativity within the band. George was the main lyricist, and most of the songs were about him and John in one form or another. And it was always an unstable force. So what made it a great band, what made the music great, was also what was eventually going to undermine it.
And it was when they broke up that George started to have behavior problems. Now, I'm not going to get into chicken or the egg, but the fact is that when he was with John, the group worked. When he wasn't with John, the group didn't work.
Once that relationship fell apart, so too did George's desire to make the group work fall apart, and as we all know, he went on a self-destructive course.
Soon after George's relationship with John Moss ended, he wanted to escape London.
George decided to move to New York. It was a fatal decision, a fateful decision, and he'd rented an apartment in Manhattan. And George was introduced to drugs. He, up to that point, he hated drugs, hated people taking drugs. For him, it meant a loss of control, and he was someone who always wanted to be in control. But then he started smoking a few joints, and he was introduced to ecstasy. Within a matter of months, it progressed to cocaine, not just snorting cocaine, but freebasing cocaine, and then heroin. I think he was bitterly upset with the failed relationship with John, and he just didn't care anymore.
For 2 years, he'd walked the high wire, and he'd stayed on it. With everybody looking at you, there is an invitation to fall off.
George was bored. George has got a very short attention span. He needs amusement. He needs attention. He needs diversion. He needs people to bounce off. And if he wasn't getting that stimulation from the band, then he wanted to get it elsewhere.
George's outlook on drugs in the early part of my fame was sort of like looking it on with a sort of this isn't good, you know, this is like a bad type of thing. And I remember having him in my house with Ronnie Wood from the Stones, and we kept, because my mother was there, and we kept disappearing into the bedroom. And by this time, heroin had actually crept in, and George's career had obviously taken off in a big way. He'd always be sort of saying, I know what you're doing in there, I'm not stupid, you know. I think I was, to say, shocked when it sort of appeared in the papers that George was going to die from heroin. It's an understatement.
By 1986, when the press had exposed his problems, Boy George had no option left. He publicly admitted his heroin addiction and that he desperately needed help.
You have a lot of fans who follow your example. Do you have any message to them?
All I can say is it's a very, very dangerous drug. The withdrawal symptoms are very, very frightening. They're very painful. It's like being in hell. I mean, I've never been there, you know, but it's very unpleasant. And any kid thinking of taking it, don't.
Just when it seemed as though things could not possibly get any worse for Boy George, they did. By 1986, at the age of 25, Boy George had split with his lover, John Moss. His Grammy-winning band Culture Club had broken up, and he admitted publicly that he was addicted to drugs. In mid-July, George was arrested for possession of heroin. Only days after his arrest, several drug-using friends were at George's house when one of them, keyboard player Michael Rudetsky, died of a heroin overdose.
So George's drug-fueled world was spiraling out of control, and the people around him were spiraling out of control. Then he ended up very near death, and I believe that both Tony Gordon, his manager at the time, and Richard Branson pulled him out of that, and I think he stayed at, I know he stayed at Richard Branson's house because I spoke to Richard Branson on the phone about it, and George was there, and they kind of pulled him away from that to try and save his life.
His father tried to set fire to the house, amazingly, to try and get him to stop. They were talking about kidnapping him and taking him to Ireland. There were all these crazy plans because no one could really force George to do anything that he didn't want. Eventually, they succeeded, and he did come off it with the intervention of Richard Branson. He went to a rehab place, and he finally won through.
Soon after George was released from rehabilitation, he started to plot his future as a solo performer. In February 1987, just over 6 months after his arrest, George released his debut solo single, Everything I Own.
Myself and the band and George, we've always been huge, huge reggae fans. The Ken Booth original was one of those great songs that we loved all the time. So it seemed inevitable that he would do a cover because he didn't have the band around him, and it was an obvious choice. It was a big hit, and I think it was the timing was absolutely right.
The big market, the US, remained elusive, however. No longer a pop idol, George turned his talents toward the underground club scene. In 1989, he formed his own record company, wrote his own music under the name of Angela Dust, and sang under the pseudonym Jesus Loves You. Although he never achieved the phenomenal level of success he had with Culture Club, he did attract some critical praise.
I would have to say that although all four were talented and brought something to the table, that George was the driving creative force, because he's the only one of the four who had some success afterwards. And he certainly showed afterwards that he didn't run out of ideas. He did a lot of different things, some of which were not successful. But that's probably because he didn't have all the correct ingredients. Culture Club, he had all the correct ingredients. Jesus Loves You, he didn't have all the correct ingredients. But put him with the Pet Shop Boys for The Crying Game, perfect, it worked.
The Crying Game, I think, was a more interesting track because it was a great film, and I think George's sadness in the delivery of his vocal, I think, is what captured everyone's heart. It was a very sad vocal, but it had a quality about it that was unique.
The Crying Game was George's first pop hit in the US since the breakup of Culture Club, 6 years earlier. It peaked at number 15 in America. It charted all throughout Europe. And in Canada, it climbed to number one. The song also earned Boy George his first solo Grammy nomination for Best Male Vocal Performance.
The Crying Game was a song that Neil Tennant asked George to sing, and it was from the movie of the same name. It briefly revived George's career in America. I don't know that George was so delighted. I mean, he loved success, but he didn't see it as, oh, this is my chance to get back, necessarily.
George also branched out into clubland, and he began DJing in London's chic night spots. He was commissioned by Mega Club, the Ministry of Sound, to compile their first mix CD, and he shifted over 1 million units for the brand.
I've had him DJ for me a few times. Yeah, I mean, I like the way he DJs, but I mean, I'm not somebody that likes sort of hardcore, you know, dance DJing. I like people that drop the odd sort of 80s, like classic in, which doesn't have to be too cheesy. It can still be sort of, you know, he's good at mixing as well.
I think he has got a fantastic ear for music. You know, obviously there's a whole art in blending all that, which is, you know, goes over my head. But he obviously must be incredibly good at it, that he can, you know, pick up the crowd and, you know, that they can be jumping up and down. And I think then together with his persona and, you know, all that really does add to that, cute hats and all that.
George continued to DJ throughout the world, but in 1998, over a decade after Culture Club last released an album, the band astonished everyone by putting their differences aside, and they reformed. Culture Club stormed the UK charts with a top five single, I Just Want to Be Loved. But despite Culture Club's return to the charts, their reunion album failed to make it into the UK top 40, and the band split up again. George was determined to reinvent himself once more on the world stage, but his personal demons were about to return. By the end of the 1980s, following the breakup of Culture Club in 1986, lead singer Boy George struck out on his own. Following a stint in a drug rehabilitation clinic, George continued recording his own music, as well as appearing as a DJ in major clubs throughout the world. Culture Club briefly reformed in the late 90s, but after their reunion album bombed in the charts, George decided to try his hand at musical theater. In 2002, his stage play called Taboo opened in London's West End. It was a semi-autobiographical show based on the life of George and his friends during the heyday of London clubland.
I thought Taboo was great. I thought The songs were great, and I really thought it was a brilliant musical.
The way George managed to encompass the theatre way of writing songs I thought was really, really clever, that it still sounded like a George song and George's melody delivers, but some of the rhyming couplets were much more theatrical. So I was very impressed with that. The guy that played the younger George was brilliant, absolutely brilliant. I had to wait several nights, even that George got, you know, special tickets. I didn't have the choice of any night. He said, well, I can get you in on such and such a night, because it was sold out.
Over its year-long run, Taboo was nominated for a Laurence Olivier Award and a Hilton Award for Best New Musical, a testament to the fact that George still had the creative edge that had once made Culture Club an international sensation. Taboo also attracted the attention of American comedian and talk show host Rosie O'Donnell, who offered to finance a Broadway run of the show. Opening late in 2003, the show earned 4 Tony Award nominations, including Best Musical Score. However, the show was a commercial flop.
Anything that goes to Broadway has a commitment of millions because you have all the unions involved, the houses are big, you've got to fill them, there's got to be publicity, there's TV publicity and ads. To an extent, there is not in Britain. So there's so much spend before money is taken at the box office. This does not happen in Britain, where shows usually find their audiences. And so ironically, even though it was far more publicized in America, more people know that it happened in America, but it was more successful on its proper scale in Britain.
After 100 performances, Taboo closed early in February 2004 with a crushing loss of $10 million. Disappointed by the failure of Taboo, George opted to stay in New York to assess his future.
Fatal thing for him to do, and he went and partied. And I'd heard that he was partying probably too much, so and he's getting out of control.
Once again, I think he just gets in with a weird crowd of weird people that are... My wife famously, many, many years ago, she relates it to the Star Wars bar. In Star Wars, when they're did-did-did-did-did, and there's all these weird aliens in that Star Wars bar, some of George's friends, it's like the Star Wars bar. They're really weird people. And consequently, George is like a giant piece of blotting paper. He absorbs people's personalities, which makes George. When he's surrounded by really weird, strange people, he absorbs some of the wrong influences. And I think in the case of the New York period, that's probably a bad period in his life.
In October 2005, George made a call to the New York police to report a burglary. When police arrived at George's apartment, there was no evidence of a break-in. However, they did discover a small quantity of cocaine next to his computer and charged him with suspected possession.
He didn't have projects there. He didn't have the grounding of his family around him, which is important for him. He didn't have something to work towards. And so, no, I wasn't surprised that something like that could happen.
Hey, if George is a fashion icon and that's how he feels and thinks, well, there's nothing worse when middle age creeps in and you don't have quite the look, and he may have not had the discipline to do whatever was necessary to maintain himself. Drugs sometimes can be a wonderful way to forget.
When George appeared in court, he petitioned the judge for permission to stage a charity concert. The request was denied. And George was sentenced to spend 5 days picking up garbage on the streets of New York.
Wouldn't it be better if he did something, even with, you know, sort of drug users or, you know, something to be in that environment to help there, rather than, you know, to sweep the street? What lesson did he learn? I really don't know, but I don't think very much.
He'd been on the streets in the beginning. It wasn't as if he was coming from some royal family or a person that was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. He'd seen poverty, I'm sure. He didn't come from rich background. There was nothing middle class about George. George was strictly an old-fashioned Irish working class.
If they wanted George to do some public service or some recompense, maybe he should have gone to a prison and worked with talented musicians and artists that are in prisons, talked to them about singing or vocal coaching, things that he's really good at, which would have been private and wouldn't have been filmed. The moment you give out that kind of penalty, oh, we want you to tidy up the streets, the paparazzi are going to have a field day.
As a result of the media frenzy, the New York Sanitation Department allowed George to complete his community service at their headquarters.
For everyone's safety, yourselves included, for the safety of George O'Dowd, the personnel that were working with him, presently what they're doing is they're on the other side of the fence cleaning around the parking lot area.
I don't believe that anybody who has to be sentenced to public service is happy. But the joy comes from within, from the personal things that outsiders don't know.
After 25 years in the public eye, Boy George still remains a magnet for bad publicity. But after making too many headlines for all the wrong reasons, was his career finally over? The legacy of Culture Club and hits like Karma Chameleon still has an attraction among their legion of fans. In June 2006, only weeks before Boy George carried out a court-imposed sentence of cleaning the streets of New York, two former Culture Club members, bass player Mikey Craig and drummer John Moss, decided to reform the band. Both Boy George and guitar player Roy Hay declined the invitation. George's replacement as lead singer was to be Sam Butcher. And although it was stated that he would not be a Boy George clone, based on the group's single performance, that is exactly what he was. All he lacked was George's rich voice, charisma, and his talent.
I think the reforming of Culture Club without George is a bad mistake, because many bands reform around the vocalist. The vocalist really is kind of the money shot of the band. If you don't have the person that sings, it makes it really, really difficult. No matter how great the singer is, they're not going to be Boy George.
While George refused to rejoin Culture Club for a second time, he still continues to find new outlets for his creative talent. In addition to his continuing career as a celebrity DJ, Boy George is now a partner in a fashion design firm called Be Rude.
I've got quite a few t-shirts that are, you know, especially for me, and I just love it. I think how creative and how lovely he is. But mine are not that rude.
George has also unwittingly used his fame to bring greater visibility to gay rights.
One thing that is probably taken for granted is the liberating effect he did have for a lot of young gay people, because it was understood that he was gay. There was no, oh, is he bisexual? No, no, no. And Freddie Mercury had been a great friend of mine, and he said, darling, one day we'll do an interview and we'll tell the whole story and we'll shock the world. Well, A, we never did the interview, but B, we wouldn't have shocked the world because George got there first.
There's a great figurehead, someone at a pivotal time where people could be open about their sexuality and say what they like and not kowtow to the great music machine. I think that was his great contribution.
One of George's most important legacies is that he was very open about his sexuality, and I think many artists to this day owe him a gratitude of thanks. His honesty meant that the landscape was much, much easier for other gay artists to come out and not be repressed. I'm a man
without conviction. Boy George is also finally being recognized as a songwriter. In late 2006, over two decades after it was released, Karma Chameleon won the Classic Song Trophy at the annual Q Awards. Britain's most respected music award ceremony.
The fact that Karma Chameleon recently won an iconic song award with Q magazine, which is a very prestigious magazine, classic song, is a real testament to how great the song is and was. It was great then, it's still great now, it's still getting played. And I think it's to receive an award like that is brilliant because a whole new generation of people really enjoy and like it.
I love it. I think sometimes he says, oh no, I don't want to hear it, but I think I'm sure he loves it too. I love it. I just think it's such a beautiful. And I think also, I remember the image that came at the time, him in those dreadlocks and everything. I thought the world went, wow.
I think he is a very good musician, and I think he's very underrated by, you know, the stuff that he does now as a solo artist as well. I think maybe going back, say, 10 years ago, there was maybe a missing part of his life where he was missing Culture Club. And it's because he wasn't getting the recognition which I think he deserved.
Culture Club may long be gone, but the legacy of its colorful and often controversial leader, Boy George, remains.
I don't think that he respects how beautiful his singing can be, because it's always accompanied by some kind of visual or by some kind of splashy context. People may not stop and listen. He is a good singer. And at any time, he could make a good record.
Over the years, almost all of my friends, close friends, and relations have met George in, you know, without the makeup, without the dreadlocks, without everything. And uniquely, they have all said, what a fantastic human being. And oh my God, how down to earth he is, and how wonderful and lovely. And he really is.
He's one of the funniest people I've ever met. He had me sitting, splitting my sides when we were working together. Extraordinary wit and insight and astuteness, but also infuriating. But that's part of the package. That's what makes him fascinating.
And you can put him up against Andy Warhol, any iconic person. He's absolutely iconic. The image of George, if you said to somebody in the middle of Africa, describe Boy George, they'd describe him. They'd probably describe him from the peak of his career in the 80s look. But it's, you can shut your eyes and you can see that image. That's really, really powerful.
I think what Boy George left in particular was this ability to be the cuddly, inoffensive rag doll that could squeeze themselves into any house and appear as if they were meant to be, right there, looking exactly as he looks. I don't know of another pop cultural icon that's ever been able to do that.
Genderbender. It's so hackneyed and trite and trivial, but the fact is, that's the most important part of him, was that he let people be themselves. And boys could wear makeup, boys could be queens, and it doesn't necessarily say anything else about you. You can be a regular in the top 10. You can be 6 foot something. You can do whatever you want, but you are free in your gender. And that's very liberating. That's the most important thing. It's more important than any single hit record, although, hey, what a great greatest hits they have.
George's place in history will be permanent because he has achieved so many great things. I still believe there's still a great album in him to come. I think he just needs to be surrounded by the right people. He's probably got one of those great albums inside. Some of Bob Dylan's greatest music has just been recorded. The very last album that Johnny Cash made was one of the greatest albums he'd ever made in his entire career. George could do exactly the same.